Yeah.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Took us everywhere from vaudeville, ragtime, to church. To you.
To me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you for sharing.
Thanks. I feel one of the things I like about the reason why Elastic Arts is so great for me is because people listen to what they like, so they want to know what kind of music I play, and I don't want to answer them like, what was that? I don't know what that was.
Well, when a person talks about fitting into a box, right?
Yeah.
Is that like just not a thing for you?
I don't know. I have tried, folks, my whole life to fit into any box. Where's the box? What is the box? Where's the box? Where do you get the box? How do I dodecahedronify to fit in this I've just never been able to do it. I trust. If I could, I would. But I'm giving up because, you know, I'm 41. I don't know if I can. But then I was just like, well, ooh, or I could find a place in which I don't have to fit in the box.
Yes! Places like this.
Yeah. Chicago's been really, really nice to me in that way.
I feel you.
Yeah.
I feel you. Is there something about musical practice that you're able to feed your emotions into and to you take what life has given you and you transform it or transmute it?
Yeah.
Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Yeah. I thank God, who I still believe in. Thank God. I don't even know what form the God is, but like thank who, whatever being is like sustaining, maybe it's the sun, I don't fucking know. Thank whatever it is that I found music, because Julian Otis, I would be lost if I didn't have music, because I have been able to work out, here I go quoting the Bible again. There's a Bible verse that talks about how there are things that cannot be uttered, but the Spirit can utter them. It's like why, it's like I grew up in a Pentecostal church. Could you tell? They say
where's
that when you,
doing?
You listen, they say that when you pray in tongues, it is your way of communicating to God things that the deepest yearnings of your heart that English or whatever your native language is cannot do. I have since given up being a holy roller, but it's made its way into my music. But I feel like music, even just like, not even words, just like chords or passages or utterings really have helped me process the hardest of times. And like not even like my music, just music in general. Like, oh my God, the other day, two examples. The other day, a few years ago, when Philando Castile was murdered, I was on tour, and I remember being in Albany, New York, and I was just like, I'm in the North, I'm cool. What, tell me why I was in a Wendy's and a bitch walked in with like Confederate flag pants. The pants had like it was like well designed Confederate flag pants. It was like the cross went up here and then the cross went here and there was like a jumper that went. No, it's just like, that is an outfit. But like, please, I don't want to be here. But like, I was like, and I was on tour with these beautiful two very skinny white boys who just could not understand. And I got in that car and I just put Nina Simone's Brown Baby in my ears and just cried. And I don't think anything else could have really done it for me at that moment. And then just the other day, I was feeling a certain way about a friend, and I put on Beyonce's Jealous, and I just felt better. It's just, music is just so, yeah, it's healed me. What about you? Like, how has that worked for you, especially because one of us went to school for music, and it wasn't me.
Oh, stop. I don't know. I have some thoughts.
Tell me about them.
I feel like music is a street profession.
Okay.
You know, I think it's something that you learn, and I feel like it should be something that you learn out in the street.
But then how did you reconcile with that, with your fancy degree?
Oh my gosh. My fancy degree, like, it doesn't make you a musician. It doesn't.
Okay.
It literally is the doing of the thing, and that's why I say it's a street. It's a doing.
Yeah.
Now, that's what I mean by street people. Like, street people
yeah.
do stuff every
yeah.
day
yeah. Yeah.
in
yeah.
order to make sure that they're able to live and survive and have, it's like a vocation.
Yes, yes.
It's like a vocation.
Vocation, a word. I'm going to write that down. Vocation. Because here's the deal. I have a complicated, a partner word of vocation is calling. But, like, because I almost went into the ministry, guys, oh, my God, the word calling. Like, feels weird to me, but I love vocation. I'm gonna write that down.
Yo, it's something you do every day. Mm-hmm. It's something that you feel like you need to do in order to be whole. And that degree, it gets you into places and doors.
Mm-hmm.
But honestly, like, in terms of musicianship, that is a personal journey. And it has been for me, like, because I took some voice lessons.
Like as a kid?
No.
Ooh.
College.
What?
I was a science major, and I was trying to be a doctor. Wow. Yeah, that whole thing. I went to International Science Fair twice.
Woo!
You're like a nerd.
I'm a nerd.
Oh, you're all alert.
We're all nerds. Yeah.
Wow. Okay. No. So then, what was the term? Okay. Whoa.
Yeah.
Whoa. You went Northwestern?
Temple.
Okay.
Philly. So I was in Philly for 5 years.
Doing science shit?
Well, I my freshman and sophomore year I did it, and then I switched. Boom. Because I wanted to be an RA and wanted to do a lot within the college community or whatever. And I took a voice class. So the first voice lessons I had was with a group of people. And then I asked her, like, can I take private voice lessons with you? And she was like, yeah. And I was like, you have a pretty nice voice. Maybe we can get you into the music school.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, what? Mom, Dad, I'm going to be a musician. They were like, what the?
Yeah.
And so my expectation going in was that, okay, if you go to music school, they're going to provide you with everything that you need in order to be a musician and to do that job well.
Right.
And there's so many gaps. Look, just think about it. Theory is, you have usually four 2 years of it.
Okay.
4 semesters of it. But it takes a lifetime.
It does. Especially if you're like black. Or like, especially if you're from a musical culture, it's just like, I already have that like written in my DNA though. Kind of, you know?
Yes, absolutely. But everywhere you turn in the academia, it invalidates that, right? And to the point where like, you don't see black alumni coming back as teachers or as just guest artists very often.
Mm-hmm.
Like, actually, like Eric Owens did come to our school, and he used to be black baritone, bass baritone, and that was interesting to see that. But the world of music didn't open up to me until I started to look into doing more experimental stuff and start to see people that looked like me.
Yeah.
And like, okay, this is a lane that I could get in, because every door that I like really people didn't respect, well, I don't think it's a respect thing. It's just the opportunities never really popped off until the last semester of grad school.
Damn.
Yeah. And then George Lewis had auditions here in Chicago because he wanted to cast Chicago people in an opera about the AACM, or the Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians.
Uh-huh.
And he picked me to do it, and I was like, this is my first big opera gig. And I was just like, still a kid, but like a grown-ass kid, you know? And that feeling of being on tour and being nurtured by other black artists, the stage manager was black, like her assistant was, you know what I mean?
Listen. One of the reasons why I moved to Chicago was because I was just tired of being the only black person. I was tired of like choosing between my identities. I felt like I couldn't play classical music and be black. Even though I knew that like Nina Simone did it, Alice Coltrane did it, Roberta Flack did it, why can't I do it? And so it's the nurturing with other black musicians is
That's it.
It's so big.
Yo, because we don't always get, we don't always get the chance within our white circles in order to be our full
self.
Yes.
Oh, beautiful white people. They really try.
Yo.
They really did try. But I think, I don't know. I think that when I think of, I feel like, you know, I feel like every time I come to Elastic Hearts, I'm like, fuck Ohio. But for real, like it like kept me in such chains. I just feel like the nurturing that I really needed is able to happen here. Like just knowing people like you, like, okay, I'm gonna tell a story that you're gonna hate and I don't give a fuck. So every single year, do you guys know what Creative Capital is? It's like an awards. Shut up. It's awards. It's like an organization that really fosters like forward thinking creative work internationally in the U.S.
In the U.S.
Okay. Okay. So every year I'm on their email list and just like, you know, like I'll just peruse and see like what's in there, and every year I look at who wins the music awards. So in 2020, I was just like, okay, who won? And I saw this person with, you know, a beautiful smile, beautiful bright glasses, and then that was the year that I think Tamika Reid also did something that year. There was like three people who won, and this beautiful black man. And I was just like, oh, that's interesting. I watched all his videos, and I was just like, wow, that man is just. That is just beautiful. That's great. Okay. Fast forward. I come to Chicago, and I'm like Googling like crazy, like trying to figure out like where to play, blah blah blah. I find out about Elastic Arts. I peruse their website. I'm like, AfriClassicals, that's me. I'm African and I play classical music. Yes. So I email them, and then this like J Otis whatever at Gmail answers. And I was just like, Otis, where have I seen that name before? And I looked at the picture and I was just like, I've seen that picture before. And I was just like, is this the Julian Otis? And I freaked out on that email. I was just like, oh my God, he's never gonna email me again. But the thing is that like, I'll let you talk.
No.
Basically, I like had a musical crush on this man. I'm gay, so like I don't even have a crush on you like that. But like I like have like I couldn't believe that like I was talking to the Julian Otis, and I just have discovered that Chicago just has so many different ways of like black musicianship. That is like, and so to come full circle to what I started talking about, I don't have to find the box. I can just be in Chicago.
Yeah.
Woo-hoo. Come on.
Oh. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But I feel like it's unfair for me to ask you this because no one asked me it, and I just started like screaming on the piano. But like, would you be interested in sharing? You can also say no. Any explorations that you're going to be sharing with us today?
Yeah.
Musically?
Yeah. Today, I think it's about, it's this thing that I've been kind of working on Instagram called Experiments in
mm-hmm.
Sound. And
Yeah. It's
been a play. I've been kind of really honing in on what practice means for me.
Yeah.
And especially in developing a solo set. So like, I really wanted to focus on vocal improvisation only, using just my vocal synthesizer, and I bought a new mixer. So I'm really interested in, like, I grew up in the church,
mm-hmm.
and so those howls and cackles and
yes.
speaking in tongues is kind of like, so I grew up AME.
Okay.
African Methodist Episcopalian.
Okay.
So they like the sadiddy,
sadiddy
black people.
Yeah.
You like, so if you like get happy in church or whatever, it was kind of like, who's that?
Yeah.
You know, and Pentecostal is like the other way around, where if you're not happy,
just angry and screaming and crying and rolling on the floor,
right.
and just vomiting. It's really,
it's
really punk rock, man.
And you're there all day.
I fucking loved it.
Yo.
I love fucking rolling around the floor. I was just like, look at me, I got the Holy Spirit. Yeah, it was really dumb.
But those feelings, like you were saying, like, aren't exclusively connected to the church.
Yeah.
Even though they're experienced by, I say that I've experienced those things in the church house. But what does it really mean to take those things out of that context?
Yes. And be able to have the language to like access those feelings.
Yeah.
Because
it's not a language that one is taught or, you know.
Yes. Yeah.
It's one that's seen,
mm-hmm.
imitated, and then the imitation.
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
Wait, don't let the imitation become real.
Yes.
And that's when, ooh, you feel that energy in your body,
mm-hmm.
from the base of your spine to the top of your head,
mm-hmm.
and you're like, yes, mm-hmm. that place is where I want to live.
Yeah.
And so, like, if I can get to a point in my music where I'm in that happy place, that's where I want to be, and that's what I feel like people feel. So I don't use a lot of text, but I have this Creative Capital Award thing, and
mm-hmm.
part of it is
yes,
about.
Yes, you sure do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's about utilizing text in order to have deeper conversations about critical race theory through improvisation.
Yeah.
And so I did bring some text just to play along with today, just to see what it's gonna produce. So, and usually I just randomly pick a page, randomly pick a paragraph, and go for it. And let the music happen from there. Angel says, Angel Back to Weed, I play with her, and
mm-hmm.
like, she always, she's
who
like,
I also thought I would never meet. And then, like, she's like, yeah, I live here. I'm like, what the fuck is Chicago?
Yo.
I was just like, what is she doing? Anyway.
Yo, no. Are we here?
Yeah.
Are we here? We live here.
Julian.
What's up?
I'm going to cut you off because I would like to take this break and then experience what you're talking about.
Oh, this was a very, very, very beautiful conversation.
Yeah.
I really appreciate it.
Thank you guys for being here. I, like, you don't understand, like, I don't, like, how many of you have lived in Chicago for, like, more than, like, 2 years? Yeah, okay. More than 5 years. So, like, bitches, you do not understand, like, what this is, like, this is a treasure. This is not, like, coming to this place, it sounds like I work here. I sound like fucking Adam and Eve. But you don't understand, like, people like me who are, like, wandering around the world just trying to figure out, like, where they can play their fucking weird-ass music. And, like, it is just so nice. I've been searching for, ever since I was cognizant, for, like, 38 years I've been searching for a place like this. So thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for, talking with me, you Creative Capital music school grad, and we're gonna take a break. Thank you. Okay, bye.
We'll be back in about 10-15 minutes.